Since I started with the RISC-U embedded hardware CTF competition, I started to do a bit more hardware related videos, and some of you struggle to understand the basics of electronics. And instead of making a basic tutorial video, I thought I'd do a collaboration with another channel, Electronics Idiot. So we built a simple prototype for a door lock with a pin pad entry. We kept it simple with only 4 buttons, 3 LEDs showing the status and a motor that would actually unlock the door. If you type in the wrong code, then the red LED will start flashing, and the more wrong tries you have, the longer it will do that. And when you enter the correct pin, the motor will start spinning to unlock the door. If you are interested in how this prototype is built and you don't understand what all these components are for and generally want some introduction to electronics, follow now this link to Electronics Idiot's video and come back later. It's also linked in the description below. Now, let's get ready and attack this lock. First of all, let's make some assumptions. Let's assume you don't have access to the microcontroller and to the motor to unlock the door. Otherwise, you could just directly cut the wires of the motor and hook them up to your own power supply and unlock the door. But obviously, the pin pad and the LEDs have to be accessible. But not only that, also the power supply is exposed, because maybe the lock is running from a battery in a cheap safe and you need to be able to change that. Our goal is to unlock the door, and the obvious attack would be to try every possible pin as fast as possible. But where do we start? We have these buttons that enter the pin, and obviously buttons also just modify the voltage on the input wire to the lock. The wire is always low, but when you press it, the wire is pulled too high, 5V. And the LEDs are just connected to those wires of the lock, which usually outputs a low, which is not enough to turn the LEDs on, but when the output is set to high, the 5V, the LEDs will turn on. So you can just imagine that in these locations are either zeros or ones. For the buttons, you decide which one it is by pressing the buttons, and for all the LEDs, the lock decides the state of the 0 or 1. Now we want to interact with the lock. A very simple prototyping platform that everybody knows is Arduino, so let's use that. First of all, we have those status LEDs. Especially the blue one is interesting because it tells us that the pin pad is ready for input. Let's take off the imaginary front panel of our lock and hook up 3 cables to the LEDs. And remember the 3 I/O pin numbers we use on the Arduino because we need it when we write the program. We know that the lock will output here a digital 1 or 0, which is basically 5V or 0V depending on if the LED shall be turned on. So we can just read this value on the pins that are now connected to the lock LEDs. We can take one of the example programs that read one input pin and send it to the computer via serial and just modify that. We define which pin number correspond to which LED, set those pin to input mode, and then we simply extend the program to read the current value from the wire and write it out to serial. This is happening in a loop many, many times per second. Now if we program our Arduino board and open the serial console, we see that the blue LED is turned on, we read a 1, because the lock is putting out 5V on that wire, and the other two LEDs are off. And obviously when you type in the wrong pin and the red LED is blinking, you can see that easily as well. Now we need something to press the buttons for us. Again, this is super simple with an Arduino. We just hook up 4 cables to the buttons. The microcontroller of the lock reads the status of the buttons exactly how we just implemented the reading of the LEDs. This means we just output a digital 1, 5V from this pin via those cables to indicate pushing the button, and a digital 0 if we want to release the button again. It's so simple. So when you write code to enter every possible pin combination, we define which output pin corresponds to which button and set their pin mode to output. And then we write a couple of nested for loops, one loop per pin digit. To see that in action, we can output which buttons would be pressed via serial, and you can see it quickly loops through all the possible combinations. Now we simply have to write the code which presses the buttons in a sequence, like we would by hand. That's simple. But before we press the buttons, we should make sure that the pin pad is ready for input by checking the status of the blue ready LED. We can write a while loop which waits for the LED to turn on. After that, we know we can now enter the pin. To do that, we just set the output pin to high, wait a short amount of time and put it back to low. That's like pressing the button by hand, and then we do this for each digit. This code now types in all possible pins for us, so we don't have to do that. And that works already pretty well. But the issue is that with each failed attempt, the lock increases the timeout. After a couple of attempts, the time is so long that it starts to become unfeasible. This means we need some kind of vulnerability that allows us to make this brute force faster. While playing around with the lock, trying to understand all of its behavior, you might realize that when you reset the board, for example when you cut the power and reconnect it again, the timeout resets. The memory of the number of failed attempts seems to be lost after the power is removed. And this is where we can attack. To simulate cutting the power, I connect another cable to the reset pin of the lock. And in the code, after we enter the pin, we check with a loop for the red failed LED. If that LED turns on, we proceed to pull the reset to low and back to high, which restarts the lock. Then we enter the next loop, wait for the blue LED, which indicates the lock is ready, and then we enter the next pin. And now we can brute force the pin fairly quickly. Just takes a minute or so, but then it finds the correct pin and the motor spins. Also, because our code was waiting for the red LED, it will not continue to try more pins. This theoretical attack is not unrealistic. For example, there was this iPhone lock screen brute force where you would cut the power aggressively after a failed attempt before the failed attempts counter could be written to memory. This way you could brute force all pins even though it should be locked after 10 failed attempts. That's kind of the fun stuff with hardware attacks. They really feel like cheating in some way because as a software person, attacking a software implementation with hardware seems pretty unfair. But these kinds of things are very powerful. The person who engineers a lock like this, or some other kind of hardware, really has to be aware of something like this. If you start thinking about possible hardware attacks where somebody has physical access, it becomes really, really hard. When we start to plan this prototype for this collab, I realized that it's not trivial to create a secure lock. So think about how you would design a lock and how elaborate it quickly becomes from a software standpoint to prevent attacks like we just did. But also from a hardware engineering standpoint, you have to be able to exchange the battery and enter a pin, but you must not be able to simply remove the plastic front panel and short the wire to spin the motor. If you are an engineer, software or hardware, I'm really happy that you watched this video because once you get into the mindset of always thinking about how stuff can be attacked, you will also create more secure products for the general population.